Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for attending this webinar. With me is Jesús Ruiz, is the Chief Technical Officer of Alastria, and Javier Mora is a Senior Expert of XBRL. My name is Ignacio Boiso. I am the founder of Open Filing Association, and the topic of today is a webinar about XBRL chain. What is XBRL chain? Basically, is an exercise that we prepare for mix the advantage of blockchain helping this problem. The publication of financial regulatory reports. Why is needed something for the public regulatory reports? Because the existing mechanisms for publishing this kind of information have a big room for improvement, especially in security issues. Let me show what are basically a rough approach how the regulatory reports are published. Obviously, first of all, the issuer prepares a report, and the report is to be sent to the auditor. All the regulatory reports, at least the public reports for securities and listed companies, are customarily required for an audit to be sure that all the information is accurate. So the first step is the issuer sends the an audited report to the auditor, and the auditor in turn provides an audited report for the issuer. So at the end of this internal process, the issuer have a report that has been audited and ready to be signed by the CEO or by the authorized person inside the organization. Now the issuer send the report to the supervisor. This is a legal requirement in all the regulated markets, in which the supervisor asks for the financial statements of the issuer. Until now, this is the typical approach. What happened with for many, many, not years, decades? What happened with internet? Simply that the supervisor, instead to publish the financial statements on paper, publish that financial statements on internet. Now this report is public and everybody can access to the website of the regulator or the supervisor and ask for information about the listed companies. This is typical for listed companies. In such a case, Anna, that is an investor, can query about the reports for the listed companies in the jurisdiction of this supervisor. This typically is country by country. Each country have their own supervisor, their own publication web, their own filing rules, their own generally accepted accounting principles, their own everything. In other country, it's exactly the same. That is a clone approach, with the reports sent by the issuers to the officially appointed mechanism, that is the generic name for supervisors in Europe, because not all of them are actually supervisors. They are another mechanism for publication of regulatory reports. And in this case, the investor both can query for the reports of listed companies in the jurisdiction of both. Anna asks for the reports in her jurisdiction, and both has for the reports in his jurisdictions. What happened with Carol? Carol may ask for reports not directly to the supervisors, but for Anna and Bob in an internal or a open or a supply chain, in which we have no idea what is the path in this supply chain, but at the end of the day, Carol receives reports from Anna and from Bob. What is the problem for Carol? Carol have no security at all about the integrity of the reports she resides, even about if the reports actually belongs to the issuers. Why? Because the reports by themselves have any kind of secure mechanism, secure feature, secure information to check integrity and non-repudiation. So this is typical for many, many external aggregators of information that obviously they can aggregate information, can index information, but at the end of the day, the consumers, the users must go back to the original publication web to check that the report has been not altered at all, the integrity of the report, and that the report is exactly the same report that the legally reported report that is published in the supervisor. In this case, we have two problems, one problem of integrity and other problem of trust, because the source of trust is the publication website of the supervisor. So what has been our approach that we call XBRL chain? So for us is we are practitioners in XBRL and practitioners in blockchain. There is mix both systems in order that provide security to XBRL regulatory reports using blockchain. Why blockchain? Obviously, there are another mechanisms. One mechanism may be the digital signature, but the digital signature, even in theory, fulfills perfectly all the requirements, have practical implementation problems. Why? Because the digital signatures at the end of the day requires certification authorities. And unfortunately, the certification authorities works well at national level, but not so well at regional level, because the certification authorities needs SARIF relationships of trustee, and that kind of trustee relationships are not so easy to implement in practical terms. So the idea is why not to use blockchain in order to overcome the practical problems with digital signature. So what is our proposal? Our proposal is that when a supervisor publishes a report, the supervisor at the same time notarize the hash code of the report. What is notarize? Well, we use notarize in a very narrow sense. It simply includes in the blockchain a new entry with the hash code of the report and the identification of the supervisor. We, in a rough approach, we call say notarize, but for simplify the things, it's... So there are only two pieces of information to be included in the blockchain. The blockchain is these concentric circles of computers. Later on, we will explain how this runs, but until now, it's simply to include in this ecosystem, in the blockchain, two datas, a hash code and the identification of the supervisor that introduced this hash code. The hash code have a property, is that each report have a single hash code, and this hash code is never duplicated by nature. This a property of cryptographic hash codes that you can take whatever reports you want, never two hash codes will be identical. It's basically the like in the humans with the finger foot, that there are not two finger foots in humans and there are several billions of humans, not two finger foots are identical. In reports is exactly the same. So in this moment, the supervisor has notarized a hash code under its name. And the supervisor say, okay, I have a report of which the hash code is that. Well, why only one supervisor? The blockchain is cross-border. There are no problems at all. It's a network at the end. There are not particular requirements to be in a single jurisdiction. So there are other institutions that can also notarize, other officially appointed mechanisms, and why not? The issuer or the auditor. So there are any kind of requirement or restriction for notarization. All of them can, for instance, in the report in the top in the image, can be notarized by three entities. The auditor, the issuer, and the supervisor, and can simply say that this hash code has been notarized three times, no problem at all. So at the end, we have hash codes, one hash code per report, and the hash code also have the information of which entity or entities notarized it. Then we are able to solve the problem of Carol. When Carol receives reports from Anna or Bob, Carol can simply check in a check server or a publisher server or check server as services or their own check server of Carol. But the only requirement is to have access to the blockchain, and then Carol can ask for the hash codes of the reports she received. If the hash code is in the blockchain, then Carol is sure that first, the report has been not modified. The report has the integrity in relation with the original report. And the second characteristic is that Carol is sure that this report has been notarized according to the identity of the computers that notarize in the blockchain. In this case, if the report has been notarized by both the issuer, the auditor, and the supervisor, Carol can receive the identities of the issuer, the auditor, and the supervisor. Why is it important to have a permissioned blockchain instead of a pure open blockchain? Because in the problem is a problem of identity. What happens if someone impersonates the supervisor or the issuer or the auditor? In such a case, all the non-repudiation simply don't run. Then it's needed that the blockchain have a strong identification in order that the supervisor, the issuer, and the auditor are confirmed that are who they are and no others that impersonate the issuer, the auditor, or the supervisor. This is a key feature of the permission of the blockchains, in this case of Alastria, and is a cornerstone of our exercise. So, in few words, we have three issuers, issuer A, issuer B, issuer C. If one of these three issuers creates a report, report A, report B, report C, and the hash footprint is univocal, so each report have one and only one hash, and each hash belongs to one and only one report, and the hash can be repeated. There are more possibilities of hash than stars in the universe. So there are no practical possibility of collision of hash. Not at all. If two hash are the same, it's because the reports are the same. The other point are the identities acknowledged by this blockchain. So it requires a strong identification of participants in the blockchain in order to be sure that the issuer, the auditor, and the supervisor are not impersonated. But the practical implementation is quite simple. It's a pile, traditional pile, with a kind of code value. The code is the hash, and the value is the entity that put the code in the pile. We can see that hash A has been notarized by the supervisor set, but the hash C has been notarized by the issuer, by one auditor, and by one supervisor. That's all for integrity and non-repudiation of regulatory reports with these functions are enough for the current requirements. And now, let me pass the control to my colleague Javier Mora from XBRL Spain to create a live demo of that. Javier, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ignacio. Let's make a very quick demo in order to show you how all of this XBRL chain project works. All the materials that I'm going to use, it's public and free available at openfiling.info website. So if you want to do whatever we are going to do right now, you really can do it. It's quite simple. This is the main page of the XBRL chain project. So you can have here all the materials and all the explanations as Ignacio has been explained to all of us. So if we want to go to directly to XBRL chain website, it's right here, XBRLchain.info website. And here we are going to see two very simple functions that are notarize and check, just with the same functionalities that Ignacio has explained before. Let's try to notarize some inline XBRL document. For that, we can create an inline XBRL document with whatever tool you want. In our case, we are going to use another open filing tool that it's public on our website, and tomorrow on the webinar, and tomorrow we are going to explain a little bit more. So let's download RefX. RefX is the really easy converter from Excel to XBRL. So what we are going to do is to download this RefX tool, and then to generate an inline XBRL document with it. This is the RefX tool, and for generating a test inline XBRL, we just can create, push this button, click on this button, and it's going to be generated. Let me download the previous version, and let's create a brand new inline XBRL document. Let's create an inline XBRL document that is not yet notarized. So for that, we are going to just change the name of the entity. As Ignacio has explained before, just changing a character on an XBRL report, the hash is going to be completely different to the previous one. So just changing a little bit the name of this entity is going to generate a new inline XBRL file that is not notarized yet on the blockchain. So let's create the inline XBRL file. Just clicking here. Let's wait a few seconds until it's generated. Right now, it's the run has been successful, not fatal errors has been found. And we are going to find this inline XBRL file right here on this folder. So let's go to this folder on our desktop. It's right here. So this is the inline XBRL file that we are going to notarize this one. This other can be also notarized, is a XBRL file, but in our case, we want to play with this inline XBRL. So let's notarize this one. For such a task, we have right here the notarize function. Let's click on it. For notarizing, you are going to need some credentials. The credentials are public on openfile.info website. Our test credentials. And let's upload the inline XBRL file and let's send it to the blockchain. Writing in blockchain is always more time consuming than just reading on the blockchain. In any case, in about 3-4 seconds, our inline XBRL document is going to be notarized. In our case, this is the notary authority, that it's all this code that you can see here on the screen. And to our inline document has been assigned the hash code 37303609557. This hash code has been included on the end of the inline XBRL document. And when you download it right here on this link, it's going to be exactly the same document you have uploaded, but in this case, including this hash code. Let's download it. Can download it right here. And what we are going to do now is to check that this new inline XBRL document with the hash code, it's working properly and it's really notarized on the blockchain. We can do that with the check function. But before that, let's unzip the inline XBRL document. Okay, this is the result inline XBRL document. And now we are going to check if it's already registered on the blockchain. Just what we need to do. In this case, we don't need any kind of credentials. So what we are going to do here is going to our desktop and select it right here. Let's open it. Let's send it to the blockchain. Okay, in this case, it's a successful. This file is correct, has a hash code. That this is the first step. And then the second step is that the hash code of the file is correct, is also correct. And the third and last step is that this hash code is already notarized on the blockchain. That is also true. Okay, so everything is correct. Of course, there is so many possibilities that this hash code is not correct, the hash code is not included in blockchain, or that the hash code is not present on the document, okay? For all of these cases, you can hit it right here on the Open Filing website. You are going to find a lot of different examples right here of documents, inline documents, that are valid, that has no valid hash codes, that are notarized, that are not notarized. So you just can download it and play yourself, notarizing your own document. You have a test credential for that, and you can try it as many times as you want. You also can notarize your own inline XBRL documents or just XBRL documents or whatever you consider that you want to notarize. This is not for production purposes, this is for testing purposes, but all of these examples that you can see on the screen are working pretty nice. So now I'm going to return the floor to Ignacio in order to continue with our presentation.
Well, we have a question for one participant, but in this moment we are not extremely fluent in how to manage this. Please, the participants, send message by the chat, because it will be easier for us. Now, this is basically, as Javier Mora has commented, all of this is in internet, in the webpage www.openfiling.info website. And now let me pass the control to my colleague Jesus Ruiz, that is the chief technical officer of Alastria, to comment the blockchain background of this proof of concept. Jesus, the floor is yours.
Okay, hello everybody. Okay, so the proof of concept is implemented on top of Alastria, on top of the test network of Alastria. Alastria is a national blockchain ecosystem. Alastria is a non-profit association which is trying to develop a national blockchain network. Now, let me explain a little bit about why we are doing so and what is the role of a national blockchain network in the whole ecosystem of blockchains and centralized systems. Okay, so in order to start, let me say that one of the biggest problems in the economy and making the economy more efficient, transacting among different partners and different companies, is how do we achieve full ecosystem digitalization. An ecosystem is composed of many entities. In the picture here, you can see different companies, but the bigger the ecosystem, the more difficult it is to collaborate among these different companies. And typically the companies are connected to each other, but it is very difficult to go beyond the digital transformation of a single company, beyond simple data sharing and secure value exchange. And when you have an ecosystem which is more than just a small number of companies, when the ecosystem is even bigger than an industry sector, when the ecosystem is, for example, the whole country, when you want to digitize the whole country, the whole productive economy of a country, then you have a lot of problems. Because as you can see in the picture, and this is just a very small example, but assume that the companies painted here are not just those which are just a very simple supply chain, but imagine that they are the whole of a country, okay? Now, in order to collaborate or in order to participate in an ecosystem, then we need something that I call the universal collaborative platform, okay? In this case, to implement extended manufacturing process, but then the companies may be from different sectors, from the energy sector, banking, retail, etc. Okay? So in order to connect all of them and then share data and exchange of value, there are different possible solutions, okay? Now, one possible solution is a centralized system, okay? So the cloud that you saw before is implemented by a single entity, And then every company connects to that single entity, and then they can exchange value and data because this single entity operates a system where a single version of the truth for all the companies is held. But you can imagine that doing so for a whole country is not the right solution because everybody should be trusting on a single entity. So the problem is more than just technology. The problem is of trust, okay? Because this is a centralized system. Centralized systems are good for many things, but probably not for this use case, okay? And then in 2009, somebody thought about a fully decentralized system, which is, again, trying to solve a very specific set of use cases. In this case, the objective of the system, like Bitcoin or later on Ethereum, blockchain networks, they are trying to make possible the transactions between anonymous entities. So the idea is that entities which don't know to each other and they can even be completely anonymous can transact using a protocol which is implemented by the blockchain. Now, this was the first time that it was done in the whole history, and it was like magic, okay? And it has proved that it can work. It can work in a very hostile environment, and nobody has been able to attack efficiently the system. So the system is very, very robust, but there is not magic. There are some compromises, and the compromises are here drawn here. First, the throughput, the performance is very poor. So, for example, Bitcoin has been operating at 3 transactions per second, and when you put 4 transactions per second, this is already at the peak. Ethereum is a little more performant, but is still on 10 transactions per second. There are many activities or many research going on in how to improve the performance of these public anonymous networks, but they are going to be always less scalable than a centralized system, okay? Another major problem is that they, because nobody trusts on anybody and they are totally anonymous, they have to implement a consensus algorithm in order to agree on the order of transactions in the network, because this is the fundamental problem of distributed systems. They, as I said, they have to implement a not very efficient consensus algorithm, which they started with proof of work, and now they are changing to proof of stake and different variants, but still they are not very efficient because the problem is very hard. They are solving a very hard problem. It's how do you make a system which is safe in the presence of just anonymous participants? Because of the anonymous nature of the participants, also these public anonymous networks have to implement something which is called the crypto economic incentives in order to incentivize anonymous participants to operate the network. Okay, and this is causing a lot of problems also, like high transaction cost, volatility of the transactions. So for every transaction, you have to pay on the cryptocurrency which is exchanged in the network, and this is causing high transaction cost when the currency rises. The transaction costs are lower when the price of the currency lowers, but again, this is causing volatility. And privacy is difficult because the main mechanism how they achieve this safety on this anonymous public network is because all data is public. All nodes participating in the network have all data. Okay, but in any case, even though that was the case, the basic idea of the technology, the blockchain, the underlying engine of Bitcoin and Ethereum, was very interesting for companies. And then companies started to use that technology without the cryptocurrency, and then creating a specialized blockchains for private consortiums. Private consortiums are a small number of companies, like banks, for example, 9 banks, 12 banks, energy companies, etc. And they agreed to create a consortium using blockchain technology to collaborate among the companies without having to rely on a third party. So this is not of course, decentralized in the sense of public anonymous networks like Bitcoin or Ethereum, but it is much more decentralized in how this is governed and how this is operated than just centralized systems. Because in a centralized system, if 9 banks want to collaborate, they have to agree that one of the banks is going to control the whole system, because all the others are going to connect to this single bank, or they have to create a joint venture to operate a centralized system. And this is not good for some use cases. And this is exactly what you are now seeing. Private consortiums are much more mature than public anonymous networks in the sense that they are going live into production with very useful use cases. They can achieve higher performance because they can implement as consensus algorithms much more efficient algorithms without miners, without mining, without proof of work, and then they are much more energy efficient. And then the transaction costs are lower and predictable, because at the end this is just treated as a infrastructure. So it's just infrastructure cost. And it is much easier because it is much more controlled privacy preserving measures. But this is again not probably the solution for some other use cases. They bring a lot of value and they are being implemented, as I said, and going live. But if you think about this, private consortiums are right now being operated by banks, energy companies, retail companies, by some companies typically belonging to a single industry sector, and they are controlled by just a few. So as they are going to be created, they are going to create silos. So they bring value to the participants, but they are going to create silos, and there is a major problem which is going to be solved about interoperability. So as you can see, there is on the blockchain space, there is something, there is some space to be filled between fully public anonymous networks and fully private consortiums where nobody can enter if the consortium doesn't want to. Okay, and this is actually where Alastria is going to be. You can see that Alastria is between the public anonymous networks and private consortiums. The mission of Alastria is to become a public permission network. Some people think that this is just a contradiction, but in reality, the public word in Alastria means public as public services like in health, public education, public roads. So most public services are in reality permission. Like, for example, the public health sector in a country, you have to identify in order to be able to get the services. Okay, and the idea here is that we want to get all the good things from public anonymous networks and all the good things from private consortiums and create a public permission network which has higher performance than the public anonymous networks. Okay, of course, it's not going to be the same performance level as private consortiums, but we think it is going to be good enough for most use cases. Okay, and we can implement higher performance consensus algorithms because it's permissioned and has identities. We want to provide low and predictable transaction cost for transactions because there's going to be no cryptocurrency embedded. Okay, again, as in private consortiums, this is going to be just infrastructure with very low and stable transactional cost. And again, this public anonymous network is not going to be as decentralized as Bitcoin or Ethereum, but it is going to be much more decentralized than just a private consortium because of the word public permission. So you need to identify yourself, but there are no barriers of entry except identifying yourself. Okay. And this is the what we mean with good enough decentralization. The consensus algorithm needs a trusted validator set, and this is the trust compromise that the rest of the network is going to be doing. Okay, this network is designed from the ground up to be compatible with regulation because we are implementing privacy. So the fact that you have permission in identities doesn't mean that privacy is not there. Okay, privacy has not to be confused with anonymity or full anonymity. Okay, and then on top of the blockchain infrastructure, we are going to implement strong identities, because in order to get the network effect, just the network is not enough. You need identities of all the participants, not just the nodes, but all the entities which are going to participate. We are going to implement the strong identities for natural persons, for legal persons, businesses, organizations, and so on, and things and processes. Okay. Now, what are we doing in order to set up and operate the national blockchain network? We already have a very good testnet, which is going to be productive very soon. As I said, Alastria is a non-profit association which is open to everyone and is coordinating all the members. When we started 1 year ago, we were 70 members. And right now we are more than 320 and growing at a rate of 20 more entities every month. You have there entities of very different characteristics, like big companies, small and medium enterprises, startups. You have public administrations, you have universities, and so on. Okay, so the members, and this is critical for the decentralization of the network, the nodes are not operated by Alastria. Alastria is just a coordination mechanism. The nodes of the blockchain network are being operated and will be operated in production by the members. So each member, if they wish, because there is no obligation, they can operate a network, they join the network via permissioning, and then they just participate on the whole network. So members are collaborating on the infrastructure. As you can see in the picture, the blockchain is permissioned, implementing privacy, treated as a resilient, as a critical infrastructure. So resiliency is embedded into the system from the beginning. And then on top of the blockchain, as I said, we are implementing strong identities, but not just any identity system. We are implementing a self-sovereign identity where the citizens are going to be empowered. Okay, so members collaborate on the infrastructure, but on top of this, where the use cases are going to be implemented, actually where the business is going to be providing benefits, there's going to be competition. So the infrastructure is shared, is collaborative, but on the use cases, the members compete as in any market. So as I said, 320 members and growing, and you can see here the type of entities, okay? This is explaining how we are organized. So basically there is a board of directors supporting all the commissions and working groups and so on, okay? And you have working groups and commissions for any aspect which is relevant to a national blockchain network like this, because this is very complex, okay? And let me go to the identity. I will not explain in detail, but this is the basic idea. So you have, on one hand, trusted parties, on the other, service providers, and then you have the persona, in the case of natural persons, which are going to be sovereign. And this is the why the identity is self-sovereign. They are going to control the data, the attestations, and the claims that are going to be operating in the system. So data does not go from one company to another. It goes from the citizen to the company, okay? And this legal identity on the blockchain is being designed and implemented inspired on eIDAS. Okay, for now the blockchain cannot be certified as an eIDAS trusted party, but we are implementing this in such a way that it will be possible in the future. Okay, so we are implementing the three levels, low, substantial, and high, the three levels of assurance for an identity in the blockchain, okay? And I would say that's everything except that we are right now on test on the test network state, and we are going to be operational very soon, but there are still several challenges. And one of the major challenges is basically the governance model, because as I said, the idea is that Alastria does not belong to a small set of companies or a single company. So the governance model is critical, we want to be as much decentralized as possible. So we want to be as decentralized as the public anonymous network like Bitcoin or Ethereum, but we have to remain practical. But in any case, we are not going to be as centralized never as a private consortium. Okay. And then you have problems of scalability, because in order to implement all the economic transactions of the whole country, that's not an easy task for this emerging technology, which is the blockchain, low transaction cost. We have to implement a sustainable operating model, okay, because this is not going to be controlled by a single company that can then make money from operating the blockchain. And then you have to implement privacy of data and transactional activity in a network which is a network where everybody is going to be transacting, and self-sovereign identity. Okay, and that's everything for us.
Okay, Jesus, thank you very much. Let me, let me return if possible, because the technology here is not perfect, but it's more than enough. Okay, wait a minute. So the last part of this presentation is our proposal for the European Financial Transparency Gateway. Why? Because the situation in Europe is that there are near 30 countries, and each country have a different supervisory publication website, of which creates obviously a situation with a big room for improvement. In 2020, all the European companies listed in the stock exchange must to report according to the European single electronic format, but in near 30 publication websites. So the European Commission is promoting the concept of European Financial Transparency Gateway, and this is our modest proposal for this challenge. Basically, according to the press release of the European Commission, we have a situation in which, in few words, it's a blockchain-based gateway about information on listed companies for cross-border investments in capital markets union. This is the idea of linking existing national databases, national publication websites, in our jargon, creating a European Financial Transparency Gateway. This is something that we are currently working with the idea to present a proof of concept, as well of the, we already presented today the concept of XBRL chain. This is our concept for a European Financial Transparency Gateway. So what is the point? The initial point is, as we can see in XBRL chain, that the supervisor notarizes the hash. But in this case, the supervisor notarizes two pieces of information, the hash and the URL of the report. Only that. It's exactly the same concept that the XBRL chain, but with an additional field, the URL. So we have hash URL of the report and the supervisor identity who notarize. Advantage of blockchain, this has been designed by Jesus Ruiz, is the event when someone do something in the field of the force in the blockchain, that if someone notarize something, this notarization is included in a block, and this block is simultaneously updated in all the computers connected to the blockchain. Is the concept of distributed ledger technology. All and each one of the computers in the blockchain have a local copy of the ledger. So technologically it's quite easy. Explore each time a new block is included in the local copy and trigger an event with a new notarization. This simplifies a lot the link between the supervisor and the EFTG, European Financial Transparency Gateway. They are no link at all. Blockchain serves as secure communication channel. Then the rest is technologically, say, more or less trivial. Once you know that an URL has been included, you can simply ask for this URL to the original publication website. This is a basic, this is the hyperlink technology, is the root of internet, and you get the report. Once you get the report, this report is included in a report index, in a database for query, and the notarization, as in the XBRL chain, can be done not only for one single supervisor, can be done for whatever supervisor, whatever officially appointed mechanism, whatever auditor, whatever issuer, whatever in the blockchain. Even if one supervisor prefers don't modify anything at all, nothing at all, simply the other can take the role of notarization, because one putting any kind of connection or even a constant exploration of the publication website, then other other party or even the European the Financial Transparency Gateway can notarize. So and this is basically universal, because the report index can ask for all the European publication websites, well, all the European or all the universal publication websites. The concept is not only European, obviously we are in Europe and our original idea is European, but in fact the concept is absolutely generic. So in this case, when David is asking for reports, don't need to go to the original directory, to the original publication website. Imagine that you have to go for information about a European company, Philips. That imagine that Philips or Coca-Cola, say Coca-Cola, that is locally, Coca-Cola use local branches, local franchising, and you are interested in the local franchising of Coca-Cola across Europe. One option is go country by country, asking for the local franchising of Coca-Cola, whatever the local name is, and retrieve in all the and each one of the websites in all the European languages. Other option is go to the report index and say all the reports in which the words Coca-Cola are included, or Danone, or whatever. Then the report index can provide to you, to David, a list of URLs fulfilling this criterion, and then you with the URL in a typical, traditional and customary internet approach, with the URL retrieve the reports is immediate, is trivial. Obviously, even more, the financial gateway can also store copies of the records, no problem at all, because the records has been notarized with a hash and go to the original publication website. It a question in reality of technical courtesy, because it's not needed at all. And this is the full overview of the functions needed for the European Financial Transparency Gateway in our modest proposals. Until now, we have solved the problem of notarization with the hash, and we are working now in notarizing the URL. And we are working in two aspects. One is the report index, another is the automatic notarization with Event Notarize. Our priorities create the report index, because the Event Notarization is quite trivial. And this is our contribution to the integration of the European financial markets. And you can read all this information in our website, openfiling.info website, in which you have all the documentation, the source code of the XBRL chain, the smart contract, the Python interface, the both developed by Jesus Ruiz, the Java serverless for Notarize and Check, developed by Javier Mora. And well, all of you are invited to contribute to this effort. And this will be presented in the XBRL Spain annual event in November 26, and also in the 2044 Continuous Auditing Symposium in March next year, and very likely in the Eurofiling XBRL Week, hosted by the European Central Bank next year in June in Frankfurt. And that's all. Thank you very much on behalf of my colleagues and myself. And tomorrow we continue with another webinar for Reface, the really easy converter from Excel to XBRL. Thank you.